When we look at our practice carefully, we see how vital it is to our life. And we see that it is not something to be taken casually. But that we really need to be intimate with it, that it is a part of us. It's a bit like the food we take. Our practice is very much like nourishing food, because when we consider carefully the food that we eat, we see that it's absolutely vital to our life. And that for food to really work for us, we have to be intimate with it. And we have to digest it. And we have to chew it mindfully and carefully as part of this digestion, as part of this process of becoming intimate with it. So our practice is much like food. Not fancy, and not refined, and doesn't need to have any extra tastes added to it, but feeling the texture of it is very important. So when we realize the importance of our practice and the importance of the food we take, then we know it's important that we pay attention to the way we chew our food and become intimate with it. We pay attention to the chewing so we can appreciate the texture of our food and prepare it for digesting. In the same way, we need to pay attention to our practice so we prepare to be intimate with it, so that we are intimate with it. We pay attention to our practice so that we can, you know, have a feel of it. In the same way, we get a feel of our food so we know how to digest it. If we don't do that, we may choke. We may choke on it. If we don't pay careful attention, we will miss the vital nature of our practice and of the food we eat. And when we miss the vital nature, we will treat it casually and not give it much attention, not give them much attention. Without the determination to give our attention, we will have no stomach to digest true practice. If we only want fancy meals and pleasant tastes and entertainment, we will not feel nourished by our food or by our practice. This understanding, this feeling about the nature of practice and of the food we take, can only come to us through our body and our mind, and not through somebody else's words. We have to have our own experience. Interpretations of practice and descriptions of food and commentaries are interesting, but we ourselves have to do our own digestion and become intimate. If we can learn to practice Zazen with serious mind, with determination, then we can have our own experience of ourself, and we can reflect on our own experience, and we can become intimate with who we are. So we can say that when we have Zazen mind, then we have a quietly digesting mind that is constantly digesting, that is learning to see things beyond duality, beyond appearances, and beyond fancy tastes. We come to appreciate the simpleness and the plainness of our practice and of our food. And that's how we see our original purity and our nature, our true nature. We chew our food, you know, carefully to prepare it for digestion. And we, in that way, we create its purity within the raw and rough activity of chewing. This understanding cannot come from some distance, either physical distance or intellectual distance or emotional distance. This understanding can only come from the unfolding of our ordinary everyday activity, from the activity that we are engaged in right now. And the activity that we are engaged in right here. Now, science can tell us, science does tell us that the stars in the sky, the planets, are dark. They are dark, and they are cold, and their surface is very rough. Science can now tell us that. And science tells us that nothing can grow there. Nothing can grow on the stars. They cannot sustain life as we know it here. And these days we have space probes and satellites and the television to actually show us, to demonstrate to us the void and the roughness and the darkness of the distant stars and planets. Science will show it to us. The moon, the stars, the planets, cold and rough and void. And so, if that's so, how could Buddha feel enlightenment from seeing a morning star? How could he have enlightenment from seeing this lifeless, cold and dark morning star? Of course, to him, it did not appear cold and lifeless, or rough and dark. And he saw beyond the physical nature of a star. It was quiet and showing its light, sending its light everywhere. What the Buddha saw was this body in the sky sending light everywhere without discrimination. Everywhere, every direction. Just sending light. And Buddha realized, what he realized at the time was that everything and everyone is doing exactly the same thing. This was his enlightenment. We are all doing the same thing, Buddha discovered, despite our surface roughness. This was his enlightenment. This was his light. And as a result, he became intimate with what is really going on. He said, the story goes that he said, "Isn't it wonderful? Everything has Buddha nature." Which is the same thing as saying, "Isn't it wonderful? Everything is reflecting its light everywhere, without exception." And this is the meaning of our practice. Our practice means to give light and life to our inherent enlightenment. To pay attention to this light that we have to give. To pay attention to it so that we don't spend our life as a dead, rough, cold planet, waiting to be analyzed by science and to be told who we are or what we are. Because that's only on the surface. We can't wait to be told. We have to become intimate with our inherent nature so that we can express it and let its light go everywhere without discrimination. So the story goes that when the light of the star came into Buddha's mind, his enlightenment existed everywhere because everything was intimate with everything. Because he saw that everything was intimate with everything. And because his enlightenment was nothing but enlightenment, it exists everywhere, without exception. This was his understanding. And he saw that because the morning star sends its light everywhere, without hesitation, without discrimination, because the morning star has enlightenment, then he, Buddha, has enlightenment. This was his understanding. And he tried to teach us that we, too, should extend our own enlightenment everywhere. Now. Not later, but in this moment. Each moment. When we look up at the night sky, a clear night sky, this week the moon has been new and it's very crisp and clear in the sky. When we see the sky like that, stars and moon in a clear sky, we're very pleased, we're very touched, and we're very encouraged to see it. and we talk about it. We see jewels of stars on a velvet background. We see the moon, and it's the brightness of the moon, we see all of its phases. Then it touches us. We become poetic, and our heart softens. We become benevolent. But when we are no longer at a distance from these bodies in the sky, when we become face to face with the roughness of a gritty planet or a gritty star or a gritty situation, we feel cold. We don't feel so benevolent. We don't feel so poetic. We feel cold. And we start to wish for the comfort of home. When we see life at a distance, it's easy to feel poetic, and it's easy to philosophize, and it's easy to feel compassion when it's at a distance, when we're not intimate. But when we become face to face with some kind of foreign thing, it can feel cold and we can feel alone. We feel its rawness and its roughness. And in order not to feel cold and alone, we have to become intimate with it despite its roughness. We have to carefully chew and digest this new situation that can feel cold and rough. If, on the other hand, if we want all of our life's situations, if we want all of our relationships to be as pleasant as fancy food, there will be no nourishment. So it's necessary to have big mind when we become face to face with these new or rough situations. Then we can digest. And then we can become intimate. And find the nourishment in these situations that can seem cold and dark. When we can see enlightenment in the midst of a cold star or a cold and bumpy situation, when we can feel enlightenment in the midst of that, it means our mind is empty. We have an empty mind. We are determined to be intimate with the situation. We are determined to chew it, to digest it. We are preparing our mind to digest. When we are determined to chew a rough, dark situation and not spit it out. With this determination, we no longer see a star as cold, and we no longer see our practice as something casual or passive. We realize the vital nature of our practice and what it means to our life. If we see a Buddhist temple from a distance, if we see the Zendo from a distance, or a Buddha statue from a distance, it's inspiring. We may feel inspired. A beautiful symbol of something that touches us. But if we want something fancy, when we sit down on our cushion, the cushion becomes a cold and lifeless planet if we want something fancy. And we will want to go back home. But when we understand that this simple black cushion, not fancy, no fancy color, no fancy symbols, simple black cushion, when we understand that this cushion is home, then our Zazen becomes the entire universe. The entire universe is our home. And we can find our freedom and our composure everywhere we go. And in everything we do. So the way that Buddha discovered, the way of life that he found, is right here. It's right wherever we are. Our feet touch the way. Our eyes meet the way. And its sound is always in our ears. As long as we don't insist on something fancy. As long as we become intimate with it. Become intimate with what our feet touch, with what our eyes meet, and what sound comes to our ears. To digest and feel intimate. So, as we know, and as we say, and as we read, and as we preach, our everyday ordinary activities are nothing more than manifestations of the way that Buddha discovered. Ordinary activities are manifestations of Buddha's way in our ordinary life, in our daily life. So it means that it is important for us to maintain awareness and mindfulness of what we do. Maybe it starts by paying attention to the chewing of our food to prepare it for digestion. Zazen is how we digest our life. Zazen is how we become intimate with our life and with the truth. It can't be grasped, you know, intellectually or analytically. We can only appreciate this kind of truth through our practice. And there are no words to describe it. There is a well-known poem attributed to a nun, 19th century Buddhist nun named Rionen. Her poem goes, 66 times have these eyes beheld the changing scene of autumn. I have said enough about moonlight. Ask no more. Only listen to the voice of pines and cedars when no wind stirs. Can we be so intimate with our life, that we hear the voice of the trees when there is no wind. This is our practice.